Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Critter Chronicles. My first video in this series spotlighted the American dog tick. You should check it out if you haven't. While dog ticks might be nasty critters, in this installment, we are going to focus on a truly terrifying creature that is the stuff of nightmares. If you have sphexophobia, prepare to cover your eyes because we are about to take a look at wasps. Specifically, one of the most aggressive species known to man, the bald-faced hornet. The bald-faced hornet is known scientifically as Dolichovespula maculata, and contrary to its name, it is not a true hornet. In truth, this hornet actually qualifies as a member of a species of wasp we in the US like to call yellow jackets. More specifically, there are two genera that contain yellow jackets, Vespula and Dolichovespula. Why is this little critter called a hornet then, you might ask? Well, to be frank, members of the maculata are called hornets because they are big, black and white in coloration, and nasty in their temperament. Translation: don't mess with these bugs.
This needs to stop now.
More on that later. In terms of location, they are largely distributed across the United States and Canada, with highest concentrations found in the southeastern United States. The species normally settles in forests and urban vegetation. Nests are generally located in trees and bushes, but occasionally are found hanging from rocks or even the sides of buildings. Height-wise, nests have been found hanging as low as 1 foot above the ground to as high as 65 and a half feet. These wasps like to live life on the edge, literally.
Woo! Yeah, baby! That's what I've been waiting for!
Now, I've mentioned nests a couple of times now. Like many other species of wasp, these critters create hanging, paper-like nests in which they live as a colony. Each colony is run by a queen and can contain between 400 and 700 workers. The workers are, like with most colony insects, entirely female. Interestingly, bald-faced hornets are omnivorous and seen by scientists and naturalists as beneficial due to their predation of flies, caterpillars, and spiders. However, their extremely aggressive nature and vigorous defense of their nests makes them a serious threat to humans. Why so threatening? Well, I haven't mentioned it yet, but it should be quite obvious that these wasps can sting, and not just once. Like most wasps, they can and will sting multiple times, unlike honeybees. With this brief overview of the maculata out of the way, let's take a look at some physiology. So, what's the deal with this hornet or wasp business, anyhow? It is simply a difference of genus, driven by variations in size, coloration, and temperament. While yellow jackets and bald-faced hornets are members of the Vespula and Dolichovespula genera, true hornets are members of the Vespa genus. Here's a look at the taxonomy of bald-faced hornets. To hammer the point home, the maculata are large like hornets and colored like them, so they adopted the name hornet. Other than being disturbingly large in size, from half an inch to 3/4 of an inch, the anatomy of bald-faced hornets is pretty similar to many other wasps, though there are a metric butt-ton of wasp species out there, bordering 20,000, they all share some fundamental traits. So this is kind of a generalized lesson on wasp anatomy. Don't worry, there won't be a test. Like all members of the insecta class, wasps possess hard exoskeletons of chitin, separated into three body segments: the head, thorax, and abdomen. Notable features on the head are sensory antennae, freaky mouthparts for biting, and quite a few eyes. The big eyes are compound, while the little dots on the top of the head are simple eyes. A wasp's thorax houses all six of its legs, as well as its super fast wings. Both the wings and legs are no joke, and a wasp can easily carry its helpless victims away. The abdomen contains most of the organs, and in females, the infamous stinger. Wasps were truly designed to be predation machines. Funnily enough, adult wasps tend to become little insectoid vegans, preferring to dine on flower nectar like bees. However, like good foster parents, they still bring meat back to the nest for their young. Speaking of bees, I'm sure many people wonder what the difference between a wasp and a bee is anyway.
Are you sure about
this? This is a pretty big topic, but here's a snippet. The bodies of wasps are more streamlined than bees, with their waists and legs narrower and their bodies devoid of pollen-grabbing bristles. Why? A wasp has the body of a hardcore predator, not a flower-loving forager. I also mentioned previously that wasps can sting more than once, as their stinger remains intact after a sting. This makes them much more prone to stinging when compared to honeybees, who seem to know stinging will end their life. One last thing too, of course. Honeybees make honey. Wasps do not make honey. I urge you to not eat anything that comes out of a wasp nest. You will probably regret it. Before we move on to the life cycle and colony dynamics of the maculata, let's take a look at the unique anatomy that separates it from other wasps. Honestly, it really is only a difference of size and color when compared to yellow jackets, not to repeat myself again. Bald-faced hornets have mostly black bodies and a predominantly white-patterned face, hence the term bald-faced in their name. They also have two slanted lines running from their midsection toward their head and on the latter part of their abdomen. They are pretty much jumbo-sized wasps with a custom skin variation that Mother Nature bought with real-life cash. Bad joke? Sorry. Moving on then. Actually, before we move on, I'd like to note that bald-faced hornets have a horrific little trick up their sleeves that I'll be revealing soon enough, so stay in your seat. Also, a friendly reminder to like the video and subscribe if you are enjoying it. It would mean a lot to me in this series. Each spring, mature queens that were fertilized at the end of the previous season begin the process of founding new colonies. When a queen decides on the ideal place for her nest, she begins building it, lays her first batch of eggs, and feeds this group of larvae. FYI, a queen maculata can lay up to 1,500 eggs a day. She doesn't mess around. Anyhow, the first generation of eggs become workers and assume the task of expanding the nest. This is normally done by chewing up wood, which mixes with the starch in their saliva. They then spread it around with their mandibles and legs, and it dries into the thin, papery structure we all know and fear. When building is primarily done, workers will guard the nest and feed on nectar, tree sap, and fruit pulp. They apparently really like apples, so hide your apples, southern US. They also prey on insects and other arthropods, chewing them up into some fresh, ground bug and feeding them to the larvae. Let it be known that these absolute menaces have been known to scavenge raw meat. I'm talking meat, not bug meat. In late summer and early fall, the queen begins laying eggs that become drones, aka males, and new queens. After pupation, these fertile males and queens fly off to mate. Let it also be known that these males are actually quite large and not pathetic like those of many other bugs. Though, they cannot sting. Once winter rolls around, any fertilized queens will tough it out in a nest and start new colonies during the next year. Sadly, males and workers die at the end of the cycle when winter is on the way. The old queen, if not killed by workers in the ultimate act of betrayal, dies with them around mid-autumn. The life cycle of a colony can be divided into the founding stage, the ergonomic stage, and the reproductive stage. This is all part of an annual cycle. New nests are usually created during the spring and early summer by a single queen, though the time does vary quite drastically depending on location. Okay, that's enough on the family life of angry bugs. Let's get into the fun stuff. Remember that little trick I mentioned earlier? Well, it wasn't clickbait. It's coming real soon. As I have hinted at multiple times before this, wasps in general, especially hornets and maculata, are pretty darn hostile. Any humans who wander too close are in for some trouble, and this also extends to when a nest is constructed too close to human dwellings. Bald-faced hornets vigorously defend their nest, with workers stinging repeatedly. This multi-sting tactic is not uncommon for wasps and social bees, mind you, but it still sucks. The cherry on top for this species, though? The bald-faced hornet has a unique defense in that it can squirt or spray venom from its stinger into the eyes of vertebrate nest intruders. The venom causes immediate watering of the eyes and temporary blindness. Ouch. Blinded by the light? Try blinded by a bug. Sorry again. The maculata can be a real pain in the rear for humans. They are very easily agitated, which combines with their odd hatred of vibrations. They can pick up vibrations through walls, plants, and even the air. This has led to instances of people getting swarmed and stung for simply mowing their lawns. Wow, bald-faced losers. Way to make chores even worse than they already are. Yeah, and if the fact that they have some sort of spidey sense wasn't bad enough, they also tend to relentlessly pursue any perceived threat. So once you have a swarm on you, you're in for a potential mobbing. Good times if you're a wasp, I guess. If it makes anyone feel better, wasps aren't entirely undefeatable bullies. Often, they will find themselves prey for many animals, such as birds, lizards, spiders, praying mantis, beetles, and dragonflies. Not so tough after all, and integral to the food chain in both directions. So, by now, some of you may be wondering what the big deal is. Sure, getting stung by a bug might hurt, but the pain is quite benign and fades with time, right? Why should we care? You see, even though the sting of a wasp carries no diseases that can spread to humans, something just as bad, if not worse, can occur if you've been stung. The issue comes into play when you consider the good old human immune system. In simple terms, people can be allergic to wasp venom. A single sting can be enough to cause rashes, hives, swelling, and in worst-case scenarios, severe anaphylaxis. Up to 10% of individuals stung by a wasp will develop an allergic reaction, and 60% of those will develop the same or worse reaction if stung again. This is no joke, people. These bugs can put you in the hospital, or worse. The best thing you can do is avoid them. In fact, let's get into that. To understand avoidance, you must first understand the nature of these creatures. As we all know, they are aggressive, so we cannot fault them for doing what they do if you show up in their crosshairs. To be safe, you must outsmart the wasps. A bald-faced hornet infestation is clearly visible with the presence of a nest, which would be suspended above the ground. These nests are really big and stick out like sore thumbs. A serious infestation will also have workers flying around the nest and nearby area. If you don't want to be stung, you really just have to stay away and avoid creating vibrational disturbances near the wasps. So, what do you do if you do have a nest somewhere nearby that you cannot deal with safely? Homeowners should seal up any tiny openings like cracks where maculata would be able to enter when seeking shelter. Also keep food covered, especially when it's outside, since we know these buggers will often scavenge meat and fruit. It's also a good idea to not load yourself up with Armani cologne or scented fragrances when outside as well. Yeah, I know, sorry to be a buzzkill. Likewise, wear covered shoes as much as you can in the yard to protect yourself from rogue hornets. Above all else, people, please, for the love of all things good and holy, do not try to remove a nest on your own.
But why? Why would you do that? Why would you do any of that?
Speak with a licensed pest control specialist. They will analyze the nest during the day and remove it at night. It is worth the cost. You absolutely, 95% confidence, will get stung if you try to remove a nest yourself. In this case, it won't be pain and gain. Just a lot of pain, and potentially worse. I'll bet my flex tape on that. With that, we have concluded our deep dive into the world of the bald-faced hornet. This video was an absolute blast for me to make. I won't lie though, it took a ton of work compiling all the footage and images to avoid any potential copyright. If you enjoyed this little adventure, please consider liking and subscribing. Like I said, it would mean a ton to me and this series. Either way, thanks for being here and learning about maculata with me. Just try to remember, similar to the American dog ticks that plague the lands, bald-faced hornets serve a purpose. They may be mean and they may be stinging machines, but they are an integral part of nature. Try your best to appreciate that and avoid them. If this can't be done, leave it to the professional to help you out. Thanks for watching, everyone. I'll see you all in the next one. Noodles Night Train, signing off.